Praise to the King. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord. Give him glory. We got a free life today from God. Free, beautiful life today from our wonderful Creator, our Father in heaven, the Almighty. He's my most beautiful. He's my most wonderful. And I love him. And I want to please him with all my heart. I want to please my Father in heaven with all my heart. What about you, my friends? He gave us everything. Beautiful life. We get to eat like kings and queens every single day. Why? Because of who? Him. So what do we do for him? Give him headaches? Complain? Yap our mouths? Oh, I got this. Think this. My friends, no. That's not the faith of Jesus. We have to follow his perfect example. He always, John 8:29, please the Father. So if we follow Jesus, we too have to please the Father. The title of this video, I can't overcome this lust. A great majority of emails that I get are from people who struggle with lust. They struggle with pornography. They struggle with lust overall. And this is something that's, yes, it can be spiritual for sure, for sure. But, you know, I hear this from a lot of believers that there's a stronghold. And because there's a stronghold, I can't give it up. And it's not just for lust. It's for other things, too. This, when we look at what Jesus teaches, at the end of the day, we all have a personal responsibility to obey him. We're going to look here in Matthew chapter 5. But I want to talk to you. Usually men suffer more with this. I believe about 30% of women now, actually. God bless you, Sister Carol. Oh, I believe a lot of women now, actually, I think 30% now watch the dirty things, the dirty imagery. I have to double check that. But a lot of men really struggle with this. Now, if you're watching this right now and you have struggles with lust, maybe you're a guy, maybe you're thinking something like this, like, oh man, you know, I haven't, I'm in my, maybe you're a married man and you're thinking to yourself, you know, it's getting boring, doing the same thing with this woman over and over, the same thing, the same routine. It's just, I'm bored. It's been years. I've been with her, the same woman, and I'm bored. Listen, that kind of thinking will destroy you. That kind of thinking is from the flesh. We're going to look here what we see in Galatians, Sister Simone. Maybe you're a single guy and you're saying, I came to Christ, but I can't take this anymore. I got to be with the woman. I can't keep waiting and waiting for a wife. I can't keep doing this. I'm wasting my good years. I'm wasting my prime years, especially a lot of you teenage boys watching this that are Christian, and you're wondering how you can overcome your lust, especially now when your hormones are through the roof. Listen, I can do it. You can do it. I'm a healthy single guy. I remember I took my computer, this laptop that I've had for years. I don't even know how it's been years and years and years. And I took my laptop to this guy because there was a Facebook virus on it. I clicked the silly Facebook link. And when I took it to the IT guy, I gave him my laptop. I said, hey, good luck finding porn on that, bro. He laughed. And then when I go to pick it up, I say, so you didn't find anything, did you? He goes, no. So I'm telling you, glory to the Lord. If I could do it, you could do it. Okay. And I haven't been with a woman in 8 years in that way. And let me tell you something. When I used to be in corporate America, incest America, corporate incest, I should say, because there's a lot of people that sleep around in corporations. I was in a big company and people were doing that. And of course, there was other offices and other companies in that building. And there, I've come across not just there, but especially when I first came to Christ, this happened like the first few years the most. after I came to Christ, like the first 4 years, 5 years, when I was still a babe drinking milk. Beautiful, beautiful girls in their mid-20s, like in their prime. Beautiful girls. Gorgeous. A couple of them were married, and they wanted to have affairs on their husbands with me. Not that I'm anything special or anything. I'm not. It's just that's just how it was. And let me tell you what I did. I ran the heck away from them, because Paul says, flee from fornication, run, because it's a strong desire we have to run from. And the proverb says, you go to that woman's house, she will destroy you. Death and hell await there. You know, and I could get into the whole spiritual things and soul ties and all that. I'm not going to get into that right now. I want to talk specifically about using wisdom primarily to overcome this problem that a lot of people watching this have. But for years and years, I could have very easily, you know, and the thought came to my mind, I'll confess, the thought came to my mind early years in my walk when my faith wasn't as big as it is now, where I used to think to myself, I'm just giving up my good years, my prime years, I'm wasting them away. I should just be bringing girls home left and right and enjoying my mid-20s and my 20s. And I remember I'd say that to my mentor, my pastor, Brother Nick. He goes, brother, what are you, crazy? What are you, stupid? He told me, what are you, stupid? I thank God he rebuked me so harshly. The proverb says that a wise man appreciates rebuke, but a fool hates reproach. I look back on every moment my pastor, my mentor, Brother Nick rebuked me. I thank God for every time he rebuked me harshly, because I needed that. You know, the mind sometimes needs a very harsh rebuke. And he goes, what are you, stupid? You want to throw away the whole eternity? Throw away everything just for one lousy night of fun? Are you crazy, my friend? You want to give up everything from God that he gives you? You want to throw it all away just for the flesh? Come on, man. Come on, man. You know better than that, brother. And when he said these things, it stuck in my soul, because my soul, I couldn't fight him back. I was speechless. I couldn't fight him back, because I knew he was right. He is right. So glory to the Lord. Hallelujah. So it's not worth it, my friends, because fornication, lust, adultery, this will split us from the Lord. And not just forever, but now too. He separates. He separates from those who are living defiling their bodies. He wants your body and my body as a temple for him to dwell in. He's not going to dwell in it if the lust is prevailing. Separates from lust because he's holy. Hallelujah. And we too must be holy. That's why the Lord says, I'm holy, be holy. Why does he command us to be holy? For what reason? There's a reason. What's the reason? So we could be perfectly united with him. He's our father. We're his children. But we can't be united with our father if we're living in sin. You, me, anybody. And it doesn't just go for lust. But we'll stick to this subject for the purpose of this video. I had a friend in college. Some of you guys are thinking to yourselves, you know, it's the life, it's the bachelor life, you know, sleeping around with women. Let me tell you something about my buddy Max from college. Now in college, I just became a Christian the beginning of my senior year. So prior to that, I was not a Christ follower. I was lost. And I had this friend Max. He was the ladies' man on the campus. Went to a smaller college. So it was like a glorified high school practically. So a lot of people pretty much knew each other. Max would sleep with a different girl every week. And he was a good looking guy. And he was with pretty much every single beautiful girl in our class. And I'll never forget this. I'm sitting down with him one day for dinner after I became Christian because I'm trying to evangelize him. And I'm sitting down with him one day, and he listened. You know, I know the Bible says do not fellowship with darkness, but you can sit down and talk to somebody who's willing to listen to you talk about Jesus. If they're not even willing to listen, then I'd say, yeah, you can't really fellowship with them. But if they're willing to listen, there's a difference there. You're not really fellowshipping with them totally. You're going with a purpose to try and spread the gospel message to them. And if they're willing to listen and hear you out, then that's just like how Jesus sat down with the sinners who were willing to listen to him. So anyhow, he was listening, and I remember I talked to him because his girlfriend at the time had left him and broke up with him for 2 years, and he thought she was the one. She was the one he was going to marry and be happy and start a life with and have children with. And I'll never forget this. He has this great job. God bless you, Brother Jonathan. He has this great job. He's making a ton of money, and I'm talking to Max, and he's living every bachelor's dream, right? Every worldly man, every worldly bachelor, this guy is living the dream that they would want to live. He's making a lot of money, living on his own, and he's bringing back the most beautiful girls to his apartment. The most beautiful girls are just literally coming after him left and right. I mean, every bachelor's dream, he's living their life. And every bachelor guy, every worldly guy that's watching this is dreaming and fantasizing about sleeping with the most beautiful women and doing the most, you know, whatever. And I'm talking to Max, and he looks me in the eye when I say this. I said, Max, I really sense that you're really, really hurt over this. Like, you really want her back. Like, you really love her. You really wanted to marry her. You still want to. You still love her. Would you give up all these gorgeous women that you're getting in your apartment every week just to go be with her? And he doesn't even take his eyes off my eyes. He goes, absolutely. It's almost like he was filling this void in his life with women. He was filling this void in his life with the lust of the flesh. That's why Jesus says in John chapter 4, you're drinking from the well of the world, you're going to be thirsty, and you're going to have to do it again and again and again. You're never going to be fulfilled constantly drinking from the well of the world. It leads to death. It's water, but it's dirty water. It's contaminated water. And you're going to want to, but for some reason, the devil's disguised a couple of drops of Mio in there. So it looks nice and colorful and sweet. And you just can't help but drinking it again and again and again. So here he is drinking from the well of the world, doing this again and again and again. And he's going to the wrong source. That's why Jesus says, come to me and I shall give you living water and you shall thirst no more. And if this is you watching this and you're struggling with the lust of the flesh and you're struggling with pornography, the enemy has deceived you. The enemy has deceived you and tricked you and put lies into your mind, just like he did to Eve, because the devil is a liar, Jesus says. And the liar wants to get inside your mind. If the devil can get inside your mind, which is connected to the heart, he takes your heart, takes your soul, and he kills you spiritually. You're dead. You're walking in sin and the lust of the flesh. You are already dead. Spiritually dead. That's why God said to Adam and Eve, don't eat the fruit. If you do, surely you will die. They ate the fruit. Did they die physically right then and there? No, they didn't. Jesus says, Luke 13:3, repent or perish. Tons of people are walking around not repenting. Are they dropping dead like flies left and right? So it's the eternal death, the spiritual death that sin produces. It's sin is the knowledge of Satan. So people go to the world. The devil set up a well. The devil tricked them. The devil tricked me at one point to drink thinking this is the sweet water. This tastes good. This is the life. This is the way to live. I'm going to watch this and take care of business. I one time sat down in front of a pastor of what's now a large church. I mean, you're talking, I don't know how many people. There's got to be hundreds upon hundreds, maybe thousands of people. I don't know. I'm sitting down with him, and I told you this before. I'm sitting down with him in a McDonald's. This was early in my walk, maybe 2 years after I got saved. So I was still a babe drinking milk. And I'm hearing from Brother Nick, obedience, holiness, and the perfection of God. Obey. And then I'm going to visit a lot of churches to make friends and fellowship, and also just to go as well. And I'm hearing the grace and the love of God, the grace and the love of God. And then I'm going back to Brother Nick's Bible, his church service. He goes, here's the grace, my friend. They twist the grace. The grace of God is this. You have a chance to repent. If you don't repent, which means you change. Because if you keep saying, God, forgive me, God, forgive me, God, forgive me, that's not true repentance. That's fake repentance. Jesus is looking for fake repentance. No, he's looking for true repentance. Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord. That's why Jesus says, we're going to read it in Matthew chapter 5 real soon. Cut your hand off. Anyhow, this pastor finds excuses. Excuses. Prideful people use unjust knowledge. Brother Justice, glory to the Lord. Prideful people use unjust knowledge. The second you find yourself justifying sin, the second you find yourself finding in your mind thoughts to justify doing something that you're not supposed to do, but you're finding ways around it in your mind as okay. This is pride. That's why the Bible says pride is the root of all evil. And the devil fell with this unjust knowledge. He found a way to justify himself. You can read that in Isaiah 13 and Ezekiel 28. When we start to let the thoughts in our mind, the unjust thoughts, and we justify it as okay. You know, I can do this once in a while. You know, the situation changed. I know this was the original, but now we're going to go do this because the situation, everything, and I'm not feeling it anymore. This is good for me. I'll benefit for it, for my health. Yeah. Jesus says, don't do it. Don't do it. You obey Jesus or you don't. And if you don't obey Jesus, how can you be a follower of Jesus? The devil believes in Jesus. Does the devil obey Jesus? Or does the devil use ideas to go against God? So if we start justifying our thoughts, oh, I'm okay. I'm okay. Yeah, I'm okay. And then you, oh, you know, God has grace on me. God has mercy on me. I can feel his love. I'll do it. And then I'll worship God afterwards. And I'll cry out to him afterwards. And I'll be cool with God. What you don't see is he could be separating himself from you. He could be hindering you. He could be allowing the enemy to set future traps and hindrances on you because you allowed the door of the sin to take over. You open that door and the demons, they watch you and they see that you gave them authority to take over. But when you're walking in holiness and obedience, the demons, they watch, the demons, when they watch and they see you're holy and obedient, they know that you're not falling for their trap. They don't have power over you. They see you have power over them. When you walk in holiness and obedience, you have an inheritance from Jesus where you have authority to step on the demons in Luke 10:19. If you're not walking in holiness and obedience, that inheritance, that promise isn't for you until you repent and get right with the Lord, walking in holiness. If you obey Jesus, are you holy? How can you be holy if you disobey Jesus? You can't. Remember, sin is the knowledge of Satan. So I'm talking to this pastor. And he uses the unjust knowledge in his mind to justify looking at naked pictures and taking care of his business. He's a married man, married for over 25 years at that time. And you know what he told me? He told me this. He goes, listen, I'm not kidding you. This is what he told me. I'm not kidding you. He goes, you're not going to go to hell for taking care of business and looking at a naked picture of a woman here and there. He told me that. At first, I was listening to him. And then he continued. He said, God designed my body to reproduce sperm every 48 hours. I'm pretty sure he understands. And I thought this to myself. Jesus never thought like this. Jesus never taught us to think like this. Jesus says, if your eye causes you sin, pluck it out. He didn't say, God gave you these eyes and you were designed to be enticed by these things. So it's okay if you do it, you know, only when you're enticed. Just don't do it excessively. He says, go and sin no more. He doesn't mean go and sin a little bit less. He doesn't say go and sin in moderation. He says, go and sin no more. And when Jesus says to the man in the pool of Bethesda, the same thing in John 5:14, go and sin no more unless something worse happens to you. He's talking about hell. So if you're watching dirty things and you're not overcoming and you're not eventually getting to the point where you're cutting it out of your life. Yeah, I know there may be a stronghold. Yeah, I know there may be a two-step forward, one-step back type deal. Well, his grace is he's giving you the chance to completely get to where you need to be. It's that time you have. You take advantage of his grace by getting there and repenting truly and cutting it off. A lot of believers, they misunderstand and they think that, Sister Diana, nice to see you. They think they're taking advantage of God's grace by goofing up and then calling it a mistake. When you know something is wrong and you do it, that's not a mistake. That's a willful sin. When you do something out of ignorance and it's wrong, and you kind of sin out of ignorance, that's a mistake. That's a genuine mistake. Although not all mistakes are sins, by the way. You can wear the wrong attire to an event. You made a mistake, doesn't mean it was a sin. Just one example. But when we look here at this problem of lust, ultimately, here's what it comes down to: lack of love for the Lord. Lust ultimately comes by a lack of love for the Lord. When you really truly love God, when you really truly pray and seek God, when you really truly know the Lord, you're going to overcome the lust. Because Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments. And if you really, truly love him, you're going to overcome. You look in Matthew chapter 5, lust, even having fantasies in your mind, any type of pictures you're looking at, and you're dwelling on them. It's not a sin to have an initial lustful thought come into your mind initially if you cut it off immediately. It becomes sin when you start fantasizing and dwelling in it and taking pleasure in it. That's when it becomes sin, because the enemy can try and throw lustful thoughts in your mind. So if the enemy tries to throw it and it comes in your mind, it's not your fault. It's your fault when you choose to entertain it from that point forward. It's your fault when you choose not to cut it off. So we look here in Matthew chapter 5, verse 27. Ye have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. I want to stop here, because some people will claim that lust is only literally plotting out to physically or literally try and make arrangements to pursue a woman in her bedroom. Even if it's a fantasy in your mind, you're living it out mentally in your spirit. That's lust too. And if you don't believe me, as you walk closer with the Lord and you walk and grow in holiness, the Holy Spirit will start to convict you that when you start having fantasies and thoughts of women that you continuously dwell in and you try to entertain them and you try to keep them going, that is lust. That is sin. And you may be thinking, this is impossible. How can any man not do this? I'm telling you from experience, I know a lot of great brothers in the faith who love the Lord, and I believe with all my heart they are genuine, and we all are able to do this with the help of the Lord. As Jesus says, with God all things are possible. Right? The apostles couldn't believe it, but Jesus says, with God all things are possible. So you have to believe it's possible, and a lot of Christians will quote the verse, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Well, then you can overcome lust through Christ who strengthens you. It's possible. I'm telling you as a living testimony, it's possible. Not to brag, but to give you hope, to inspire you, to tell you. And it's not just me. There's a lot of great brothers I know, a lot, who by the power of God, with his help, have also overcome. But remember this, the Holy Spirit will not stop sinning for you. There's a lot of believers who think God is going to take it away from me. God has to do it. God has to deliver me. God is going to do it. He's going to do it in his time. He's going to do it for me. This is absolute nonsense. Absolute nonsense. Even Jesus teaches, okay, let's say you do have a stronghold of lust. Even Jesus teaches you have to obey after you're delivered. Even Jesus teaches that. You have to obey. Obedience is your part. It's your responsibility. It's my responsibility. I cannot obey God for you. You cannot obey God for me. Hallelujah. We have to obey God. He says, when the strong man, right, when the demon's cast out, it goes wandering, looking for seven worse, and then goes back to his home, and he finds the home swept and garnished. What does that mean? The person, once they were delivered, did not follow up with the Lord. They did not get serious with the Lord in the obedience. So what happened? Brother Dove, glory to the Lord, Brother Dove. It's nice to see you, bro. Hallelujah. Well, that makes sense that are they calling you Dove now? did we start you a nice nickname, bro? I miss you, man. I miss you a lot. I miss you. You and Dore got a special place in my heart, man. I love you guys. I love you guys a lot. I really do. You guys are really special, man. I can't wait to see you again soon in the spring. Oh, it's going to be great. Hallelujah. Anyhow, where was I? Okay, the demons. We go for glory to the Lord. So when Jesus is speaking, the demons, they leave, and then they go wandering, and they bring seven worse. They find the house swept and garnished. When you're totally in obedience and you're totally following up the Lord, then the demons aren't going to come to your house finding it empty, swept and garnished. They're going to find you standing at the front door, guarded with armor and a sword in your hand. They're going to freak out and run away. So after, even if you're delivered from your supposed stronghold, if you have one, it's your job to get serious and follow up with the Lord and obey after that. Okay. So we look now, the Holy Spirit is not going to obey for you. He is not called the doer. Not one time will you find in the New Testament the Holy Spirit given the title the doer. He is given the title the helper. He will help you overcome your sin. He will not do it for you. You have to do it. I have to do it. That's why Jesus says this next. Matthew 5:29. And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish. It's profitable that a part of you dies than if you continue in sin, he's saying. And not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. And if thy right hand offend thee, cut it off and cast it from thee. for it is profitable for thee that of thy members should that one of thy members should perish, and not that any, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell. So Jesus, is he saying to literally pluck your eyes? He's saying to literally cut your hand off? No, he's speaking a metaphor, but he's saying go to whatever realistic measure you have to go to whatever realistic extreme, because he also says we take the whole Bible. He also says treat your body as a temple. You keep mutilating your body, you're obviously not treating it as a temple. But he's saying go to the extreme, but be realistic too. To do whatever it takes to cut the sin out of your life. If you're struggling with porn, go get a flip phone. The second you have the urge, the temptation, leave your house. Go run away. Paul says, flee. Go do something about it. Let the Lord see you taking action to do something about it. Go take your smartphone. Give it to your good close friend for 30 days. Go get a flip phone. You say, I don't want to have to do that. I need to. Then you're trying to find excuses to ultimately keep your sin. No, I can do it without doing that. I can do it. Cut your hand off, man. Go to the measures. You take the steps you need to do to cut it out of your life. Go take your laptop, give it to your mom, and have her hold on to it for 60 days. Get rid of your iPad. Get rid of your tablet temporarily. Go give it to a close family member to hold on to it and tell them to never, or go to a close brother in the faith. Maybe if you feel more comfortable with a brother in the faith to confide in them with this, or sister in the faith, if you're a woman struggling with this, go give it to them. Give these things to them. Tell them I'm struggling. You got to help me. Hold on to these things. I want to just boom. Okay. And in that time, when you're not with those things, you seek the Lord. You seek the Lord. The proverb says there is healing under his wing. That's all kinds of healing, even a spiritual healing. What does it mean? Under his wing. You stay close to God. Eventually you'll get healed. You seek him in his presence. Fasting, my friends, will help you quite much. My pastor always used to say this. He was a funny guy. Brother Nick, the old Greek guy. He said to me this, brother, fasting helps quite much. And I can attest to that, 100% true. Why? He goes, when you keep the tank empty, problem solved. I mean, hey, the guy was from, he was old school Greek. You got to like his wisdom, simple wisdom, but it was true. Empty your tank, my friends, by fasting. Okay, not the other way. Don't try to justify and twist it. Hallelujah. So fasting is very powerful. With fasting, you deny your flesh and strengthen your spirit. When you fast, you are literally commanding your flesh to obey you. When you fall into lust, your flesh is your master. You look at Galatians 5. Hallelujah. Glory to you, Lord. This is one of the best, most anointed Bible studies ever, Lord. And I give you all the glory for your wisdom right now. And I thank you for your what you're doing, Holy Spirit. You're our teacher. You're the one guiding us right now in the name of Jesus. All the people watching this that are suffering from the lust and the flesh and the spirit of lust, I pray and I declare that is going to be broken in Jesus' name. I speak in faith, believing for my brother and sister, feeling their pain, their sense of urgency, and their struggle for those who want to be out of it. In Jesus' mighty name, I remove the blockage that is hindering them from receiving the breakthrough and totally being able to completely cut their hand off and pluck their eye out from this sin in the name of Jesus. I speak life over them and deliverance and freedom by the power of the Holy Spirit through the precious blood of the Lamb, hallelujah, which no demon can overcome. For Christ already did on the cross 2,000 years ago. Hallelujah, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, no demon, no devil, no legion, no Satan will have the power to continue tormenting my brothers and sisters from the lust. In the name of Jesus, deliverance will happen for those who believe and strive to enter through the narrow gate. This prayer, I say it in faith, Father, in Jesus' name, that those who are receiving it right now will receive a deliverance. Hallelujah. Amen. Look at Galatians 5. Verse 16, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. But if ye be led by the Spirit, you're not under the law, right? You're under the Holy Spirit. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, which is using a lot of lies against the mind, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I also have told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Didn't Jesus just say in Matthew 5, you already lust a woman, you're an adulterer, you do this, you shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Adultery, lust. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. Crucify it. Crucify it. Fasting, cutting your hand off, giving up your tablet temporarily, giving it up until you seek the Lord and you overcome this problem, until you fully receive full deliverance, and then you walk in obedience and you feel the presence of God and you love Him and you want to please Him. And when the temptation comes, you immediately go on your knees and you start praying to God, because you say, God, how, I don't want to fall. Because every time you fall into the temptation and the lust, and you look at the dirty thing you knew you weren't supposed to look at, and you do that nasty thing in the secret you knew you weren't supposed to do, you know you have guilt and shame inside of you if you're really truly repentant. And you go on your knees to God and you start praying, because you can feel that He's disappointed in you. And it grieves you even more. You get convicted even more, because you had this good thing going. You were going for 2-3 weeks and then you fell. And then the next time the temptation comes, all of a sudden you start wrestling. You start wrestling. You don't just fall into it. You start wrestling for 2 hours straight. You're wrestling, and the thought keeps coming back. And then 10 minutes later, it goes away, because you're wrestling. You're fighting. And if that's you and you're on that path, eventually you keep fighting, you will overcome. And you keep asking the Lord for His grace and mercy. But I'm telling you this, in the meantime, God, you will hinder the Lord from answering a lot of your prayers. If you're going to take that route with the porno, if you're going to take that route with the lust of the flesh, the Lord will withhold answering a lot of prayers with you. He will. And you have to accept that, because there's consequences to your sin. You can say He loves you and His grace is on you, but that doesn't mean He's going to reward you by answering your petitions. You're going to have a lot of prayers that will not be answered if you walk in the lust and you fall to it. 1 John 3:22 says, and we ask and we receive of Him because we keep His commandments and do those things pleasing in His sight. You're not doing what's pleasing in His sight, you're not going to receive when you ask. The Lord is just and He's perfect, and rightfully so. He shouldn't be answering the prayers of those who continuously, willfully go against Him. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Galatians 5:25 and then 26. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. If we walk in the Spirit, or if we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. So you can be in this knowledge and the truth and the light, but you're not walking in the Spirit still. You're still in the lust of the flesh. If we live in the Spirit, let us also. So whose job is it to walk in the Spirit? Is the Holy Spirit's job to walk in Himself for you? No, it's our job to obey Him. So ultimately this, my friends, we're in a fight. We're in a big fight, spiritual fight. And we have to do what you need to do. Now, for some of you watching this, some of you really have a very serious fear of the Lord. This only goes for some of you. I'm going to give you a tip. If you're struggling with the lust of the flesh, if you're struggling with porn, if you're struggling with doing that thing in the secret. This is for very, very few people watching this, though. The vast majority of you, do not take this tip. It will actually make your walk with the Lord even worse. But for those of you who are seriously repentant and you're doing a two-step forward, one-step back thing, and you're really guilted and ashamed, and you feel like you're hurting God, you really feel like you're disappointing Him, you want to please Him, this is for you. Have you ever made a promise to God? If you watching this now have made promises to God and you have never broken them, this tip is only for you. If you're watching this and you have made promises to God, but you have broken them, do not do this tip. Okay? Glory to God, brother EJ. So if you've made promises to the Lord and you've never broken them, you've always kept your word with God, you've let your yes be yes and your no, no with God, this tip, I pray, will totally help you be set free. Say this, first thing in the morning, Lord, I promise you for the next 24 hours not to have any lustful thoughts, not to watch any inappropriate pictures touching my eyes willfully, and not to take care of business, so to speak, in the private for the next 24 hours. The second your temptation comes throughout the day, immediately the wisdom will kick in. You say, no, 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 no. You promised God and you fear God and I'm keeping that promise. I promised Him, done. And then you go the rest of the day clean. The next morning comes, you do the same thing and you keep doing it until you finally get to the point you don't even have to pray that anymore. You grew in the fear of the Lord and His wisdom enough to a point where you were able to overcome. Again, this tip is only for those who made promises to God and never went back on them. Glory to the Lord, my brothers and sisters. Hallelujah. If there's anybody watching this right now, you want to give your life to Christ, please say something in the chat. Say, I'm struggling with sin. I want to give my life to Jesus. I want to stop living for sin. Say something now, and we're going to say a very important prayer per John 17:20, to believe on Jesus with our word. This is the first step in your relationship and walk with the Lord, making a verbal contract, proclaiming it, that you're going to accept Him as your Lord. Please say something in the chat. Say, I want to give my life to Christ. Say that in the chat. I am consistently watching the chat right now. Okay, we have one person wants to pray. Two people want to give their lives to the Lord. Does anybody else want to give your life to the Lord? Please say something in the chat. And you've never prayed to accept Jesus. This is only for people who have never given their lives to the Lord. Say something right now. If you've given your life to the Lord, I don't want to hear what you have to say about this. Don't say, I want to give my life to Christ. I accept. Just say nothing. But if you really want to give your life to the Lord for the first time ever, you've saw some videos on the channel, you've saw other videos, you've thought, you've heard about God when you're a kid, but you went away, you finally realized it's enough is enough. I want to give my life to God. We're going to pray a powerful prayer that is very important. Also, I want you to email me, etwcministry@outlook.com. If you are going to pray this prayer with us, please email me, etwcministry@outlook.com. Any problems you're having, any questions you have, any doubts you have, your story, your testimony, why you chose to give your life to the Lord right now. Anybody else want to give their life to Jesus, please. Sister Carol, were you counting how many people wanted to give their lives to the Lord? Glory to the Lord. It's very important because souls matter. The wise win souls. Daniel 12:3. He who brings many to righteousness shall shine as the stars in the firmament. The promises of God. We're going to pray now in about 30 seconds. A very special prayer. And if you're real and genuine, I believe with all my heart, you're going to feel something come over you. It's the peace of God. He will have more grace on you for being humbly and proclaiming it. And you should be baptized in Jesus' name under a Holy Spirit-filled man of God. And immediately start reading the Bible, cutting off your sin, and following Jesus. So anybody else want to give their life to Jesus, say something in the chat. And also email me. Again, my email is etwcministry@outlook.com. You can also connect with me on Facebook, Joseph Ibrahim in Cleveland, Ohio. Joseph Ibrahim, Cleveland, Ohio. Glory to the Lord. We're going to pray right now. You want to give your life to Jesus? Say this out loud. Repeat after me and be very quiet and serious with the Lord and talk to him genuinely with all your heart. If you got to cry, don't let the tears don't hold the tears back. Hallelujah. Repeat this very importantly with all your heart. You're making a verbal contract right now with God. You want to give your life to Christ? Best decision you can make, my friend. Here we go. Lord Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. I believe you are the bread that came down from heaven. You came to teach us the perfect faith, to shed your blood for the remission of our sins. I believe you are the Lamb of God. I believe you are the Son of God. And I ask you for mercy. Forgive me for every single one of my sins. Please, Lord, help me. Right now, I am accepting you as my personal Lord and Savior. You alone can take me to heaven. You alone can save me. And I thank you for dying on the cross for me. Thank you for your grace and mercy. Thank you for what you did for us. You obeyed the Father perfectly. And now I want to follow you, to follow your footsteps, to please the Father, to become born again. Please, Jesus, help me to obey you. Help me to become holy. That you sanctify me through your truth. For you say your word is truth. Fill me, please, with the Holy Spirit, the helper and comforter, your Spirit, the Father's Spirit. The 9 gifts of the Spirit. Fill me with your power that I may glorify you and be a witness to you. I'll be a witness for you to the nations to help bring lost souls back to you. And you can use me. And I want to serve you from now on. Not my sin. I give my life to you, my mind, my heart, my soul, with all my strength. And I thank you so much for hearing this prayer. My Lord, I'm taking the first step. Walking after you. Teach me personally your wisdom. In your name I pray. Amen. Again, if you prayed this prayer, email me, etwcministry@outlook.com. I want to hear your testimony. I want to hear why you just prayed that prayer. I want to hear what made you give your life to Christ just now. Any struggles you're struggling with, any questions you may have, please don't hesitate to ask. Email me, Hallelujah. Glory to the Lord. He's a good God. He's a good God. He's a good God. So everybody, God bless you. Go in the name of Jesus. Have a good night. And don't forget to evangelize people anywhere you go. Be a witness anywhere you go in these stores. The malls are crowded. The grocery stores are crowded. Don't be afraid to witness to people. Carry tracts on you. It's your job. It's my job to be witnesses for our Lord. Otherwise, we're not really serving him that much, are we? Let's serve him more and please him and help the people that need him. You never know. You never, ever, ever know. You know how many times I'm in the store and there's somebody that I should have evangelized? Or, you know, there's somebody that I should say, I told myself I don't feel like it, but I denied my flesh and I said, no. The wisdom kicked in and punched that lousy, silly thought out. And then I said, no, I'm going to evangelize them. And I started telling them about Jesus. I said, no, I didn't know that. And they're surprised. I can't tell you how many times this happened. So you do it by faith, my friends. Open your mouth and just witness to people. Carry tracts in your pocket. Sisters, carry tracts in your purses. You have no excuse to have makeup and whatever and all this junk in your purses, and you're not going to have tracts for our Lord. Get right and get with the program. Guys, there's no excuse not to have tracts in your pocket. You're not going to have your change and your all this other stuff in your pocket, and you're not going to have tracts for Jesus. Glory to God. God bless you. Go in the name of Jesus. Serve the Lord. Be blessed. Amen.